John Ross. If Mr. John Ross can hear my voice. Here we go. We're ready for you. Yeah. Did you see the email? All right, if anybody can hear me, we're going to go ahead and start 10 Talks here in, well, momentarily.
Are we duplicating?
We should be here in just 1 second. All right, everybody, we're going to go ahead and get started. This is 10 Talk time. So we have 8 great speakers here to give some really concise information. We have a lot of new people here. So 10 Talks are typically, they're not actually 10 minutes, as the name might suggest. They're seven and a half minutes long. We're going to do quick fire back and forth at both podiums. And this is going to be a great time. So with that, Mr. Ross.
Hello, everyone. I think we're ready. If we want to go ahead and put the projector up, see if we can get that working first. Ah, very close. Yeah, we're getting there. Oh, except I hit the wrong button. There we go. All right, so what we wanted to do real quickly, 5 to 7 minutes, is talk about any of you in the Microsoft environment, Microsoft 365 environment. I'm John Ross. This is my wife, Billy Ross. One thing we specifically do is try to help implement internet portals, use some of those technologies you're already paying for. And so I said to Billy, why don't we do a live demo in 7 to 10 minutes? At a conference, because those always work great, as we all know. She's gonna give it a shot. So I'm gonna go ahead and turn it over. Go for it. Oh, yeah.
I can't hold it. He's gonna hold the mic for me. Isn't that nice? Right? So, how many of you guys have Office 365? Oh, excellent. How many of you are using Office 365 SharePoint as an intranet? Oh, a few. How many would like to do that? Yeah, a little bit more. Okay, how many of you are intimidated at the thought? Okay, so 2017, this guy here said, hey, we're going to move everything to SharePoint Online and you're going to implement it. And I said, no, I'm not. But here I am and I love it. I love it. So I'm going to walk you through how to build a SharePoint site as quickly as I can. There's a lot more to it, so stop by our booth if you want to talk more to us about it. But we're just gonna go right in. Are y'all ready? All right. So
And if this fails, I have a backup non-live demo.
And he has to ride home 6 hours with me. Okay, so from Office 365, you're going to go into SharePoint. As simple as saying we're going to create a site. Now, there are two sites available. One is a team site and one is a communication site. If you're building an intranet portal for your organization, for your church, you're basically going to want to use a communication site. So we're going to launch that out. You're going to give it a name. We're going to call this one, if I can see that, we're going to call it Billy's Site. And what you're going to find is that right here, it goes ahead and it names it and it gives it its URL address. We'll finish that up. And it's going to pop open and give us a template. Now, this is basically where things kind of, we're not going to do that one. This is where things come in as your template. You can modify it. You can change it any which way you want. So what I'm going to do is hit edit. And we're going to make this hero 3 tiles instead of 5. Now, because this is a church background, and I have a church background, I was church administration for a long time, this would have saved me so much trouble in my past. But now we have this available to us, and I think if you implement it in your churches, you're going to be astounded at the way people communicate with one another. So we're going to make this one 3 tiles. This first tile, we are going to say, let's see here, we're going to call this our prayer ministry. Let's call it that. All right. And we're going to give it a graphic here. Call that one prayer. Okay, we'll add that in. Now you can link that wherever you want it to go. It can be a page, it can be a sermon series, however you all want to link that. We could do the same thing here for a student ministry. We could do one here for maybe your worship team, maybe the children's ministry. However you want to link those out, you can link them anywhere you want them to go. All right, the next thing we will do is add a section here. Check my notes here, what we want to do. This next section, I'm going to add, let's add some weather, right? Because that's something people might want to know what's happening. And Granger, Indiana pops right in. Come on. And you get your local weather right there. You can add as many of those or as few of those as you like. Let's go underneath here and put a map. Let's say people need to know where we're located or maybe where other locations are located. Pop that in there so you get your map. All right, let's see what else we've got. So then we're going to add a news web part. There we go. Now, news web parts, you can modify these any which way you want. But when you modify a web part or a news article, it just creates a new SharePoint page. And people can link it and get to it. You can update it if information changes super quick.
The news part is the part that gets you out of email for sending announcements. Worked really well for that.
Yep. All right. We've already got an events in here, an events calendar. So we're going to change the look of that. You can add any type of event that you like. It could be upcoming events that are happening in your children's ministry, maybe VBS. Maybe it's going to be a senior adult outing. Maybe they're going to get on a bus and travel and go do something that's great fun. Put all those events in there.
Oh, by the way, this is an hour usually, so you all have to tell us when we're done. She's going to keep adding things until you all tell her we're out of time.
All right, and then let's see. The other thing we'll do, add some quick links in here. Now, quick links can link people to other sites or pages within your SharePoint tenant. It could also go to places outside of your tenant. So let's say for this one, we're gonna do a link, and we're gonna want this one to link to Bible.com. And we'll change that title there. We can change our icon, we can turn it off, we can delete it. We can also make these look like buttons. If I can click the right thing there. Am I going over time? How's my time?
1 minute.
1 minute.
1 minute. Okay, well, we're not gonna change that one. And then the next thing is a document library. I got 1 minute. Man, this was fast. All right, So if you have documents that you've loaded in, people can just get right to them. You can also share those documents if you have the correct permissions.
Yeah. Okay. So that's
basically it.
Real high level. It actually worked. But I mean, we were out at the booth. If you want to see all kinds of things, we have some pre-made portals, some things that she's done for other churches that we can show you how it works. So yeah. Be glad to show you that.
Thank you very much.
Hey everybody, how you doing this morning? Afternoon, I don't know what day it is. Anyway, my name's Jeff. I worked at a church for over a decade. Now I work at a company helping churches with technology. So I'm gonna talk to you about wherever my slide deck is. There it is, and that's me. Preventing Dante from going infernal on your network. So let's get started. Here are the answers. You can write them down and forget about the rest of the session, or you can just listen to the rest. We'll get back to them at the end. Okay, so what is Dante? Dante is Digital Audio Network through Ethernet. So it's an acronym. That's what Dante stands for. It's made by a company named Audinate. They're in Sydney, Australia, where they have that opera house and some Tasmanian devils. So just think, you know, Dante, it could be dangerous there, right? So there are over 300 manufacturers who put Dante in over 3,000 products, which are used in over a million devices in the field right now. So chances are your church has Dante on your network somewhere, whether you know it or not. Okay, so how does it work? You take two or more Dante-enabled devices on the same subnet, and you do a subscription. So what you do is you download Dante Controller, which is a piece of free software, from Audinate, you download from the website, and that's the hardest part of this whole process. Once you get it downloaded, you open it up, you put it on the same subnet, you see that there are devices there, that's Jeff's MacBook, and you see this microphone there, and then you simply click the boxes where you want audio to go, they turn green, and audio is there. Subscriptions are made, you can close the software, and they're gonna stay there until someone makes a change. So what technologies does Dante use? It uses DHCP, absolutely. You can do static addressing, and you can do a PIPA addressing. Why not? Does it do unicast? Yes. Does it do multicast? If it's enabled, it does multicast asterisk. So what do you call multicast without IGMP snooping? Broadcast. So it does broadcast if IGMP snooping is disabled and they're doing multicast. Also, it uses PTP for timing and MDNS for discovery. Okay, so what are the common issues? So your audio person, they care about no audio, audio dropout, and your IT person cares about network throughput and also networking, network loops, okay? So what are these usual suspects that cause these issues? Audio dropout would be clock election, so Dante controller, Dante itself, it picks which device it thinks should be the master clock, and so you can go into Dante controller and say, no, I want my audio board to be the master clock, and that takes care of that. Because when it switches back and forth, there could be a little bit of an audio dropout there. But your bigger issue for audio dropout is going to be packet loss if you got a problem on your network. How about no audio software configuration? If you select the wrong checkboxes and run the audio the wrong way in Dante controller, it's not going to get where you think it is. Also, you have to do some software configuration in your audio board or your computer that's also sending Dante to make sure you're routing it the way you want it to go. The other issue would be layer 3 issue. If you have the wrong IP address, you have the wrong subnet, you're in the wrong switch port, you know, that could cause no audio. Okay, so let's do some Dante math real quick. Everyone loves math. We got one flow, they use flows, and one flow contains 1 to 4 channels of audio, that's 6 megabits, or 64 channels will do about 100 megabits. Okay, so if you have a 64 channel stage box on backstage, and you go to a switch backstage, switch front of house, then you go to front of house console, you get a broadcast board and a Mac Mini doing tracks, and you got just other devices. You do that unicast, those 100 megabits, you do 300 megabits for the first link, 300 second, 100 to each of those other things, 0 to the other devices. Well, if you want to make that more efficient, you enable multicast, set that up on your switches, and you're going to get 100 megabits to the first two links, other ones stay the same, but the other devices on the subnet, are they 0 or 100? Well, if multicast is set up correctly, they're 0. If it's set up incorrectly, you're broadcasting, so they all get 100 too. So let's look at the usual suspects for network throughput. So if Dante is sharing a subnet with too many other devices, that can be an issue. So, you know, best practice, put it on its own subnet. If you have less than a gigabit link, this is Dante controller, has a nice network status tab in it that you can see the link. is 1 gigabit for that top thing, which is an audio board, and 100 megabits for the one beneath it, so it shows you you got 100 megabits link there. Is that a problem? No, because the second device only has 100 megabit link because it only sends 11 megabits because that's all it does. But if it were the audio board with 100 megabit connection, that'd be an issue. If IGMP snooping is not turned on, that could be an issue as well. If you're doing multicast, you saw the 300 versus 100 megabits going there. So there's this button that you have to hit in the software to actually enable multicast. It comes as unicast normally. So you hit that button. That button, to me, looks like a bident, which Hades in Greek mythology used in the underworld. But it reminds me actually of tacos, because then I think of the trident and the torchies guy, because that's what I think of. So anyway, all you got to think of is when someone hits that button, you're going multicast, and it could be bad. We'll see. Also, if QoS is not enabled, if that's not enabled, you're not going to have any throughput help from enabling QoS, but it's going to allow Dante to be elevated and allow it to not have dropout. Also, just to mention, Wi-Fi can be used for Dante controller, but it can tank your Wi-Fi AP if your APs are not blocking unregistered multicast traffic. So best practice, don't use Wi-Fi for Dante. You don't really need it. It only does controller anyway. Okay. So what about loops? Dante secondary device plugged in but not configured properly. That's the Dante device that has primary and secondary. Some only have primary, some have both. If it has secondary, it's for redundancy, it's great. Separate network, if audio drops on the first one because you lose a cable, a switch, or something like that, then your second path, best practice, completely separate path. Your separate path then will still have audio, you'll never hear the issue, and it'll work great. Well, the problem is, when they ship it from the factory, you gotta go into Dante controller and tell it that secondary port is secondary redundant instead of switched. So with switched right now, that does a daisy chain. So as you can see, it daisy chains through the card and goes right back into possibly the same switch, hopefully on a different VLAN, but you could cause a loop there. So Dante secondary is wonderful when it's configured properly, and it can help if there is a network issue. The main point, do not cross the streams. It's very bad. Okay, your answers again, separate your subnet. Put Dante on its own subnet. If you do Dante secondary, put it on its own subnet or on its own air-gapped network. Enable IGMP snooping so that one day when your audio guy figures out that he needs more multicast or he needs to start doing multicast to get the flows he needs, he just enables it. It's already ready on your switches. Disable Dante secondary. If you have an issue and you don't know what it is, you can disable Dante secondary if it's like causing havoc on your switch, and then you get Dante primary back up, it's happy, then you go to secondary. So secondary is good, but it can cause issues. Okay, learning more, there is a adding Dante to your network one sheet on Audinate's website. You can Google that, or you can email me at the address at the bottom. I will forward that on to you. That tells you all the network details, the QoS, all that stuff. They have great website resources as well, free training videos, and Dante controller, if you learn that, it's really great. It has lots of information in there that can help an IT person. Just don't make subscriptions or your audio guy get mad at you. And then there's a session tomorrow when AV and IT collide, and also that they're gonna talk about Dante and other AV topics that you should attend at 2:30 if you wanna learn more. And then I'm doing a session with my colleagues at before that at 1 o'clock on managed AVL. And then that's my favorite IT joke, and that's my details, and that's it.
For those of you new here, it wouldn't be 10 Talk without this really beautiful pause.
I just wanted Jason Powell to not feel alone. Do you want to do the next one? Or switch?
We'll go ahead and get Dean up here and let him start plugging in. If he's working before you, we'll do that.
I'll switch with you. Let me make sure I plug in.
Oh.
How's it
is going over here?
I feel like Bill Gates, you know? It's doing that.
Oh. Kind of act like it was recognizing.
Ooh.
Right.
Okay.
I'm taking this for now.
Mac for the win.
Got that one. Oh, we need two mics.
You got it?
Mm-hmm. You start with me.
Hi, my name's Jason.
And hi, my name's Dean.
Now you're awake.
Yes.
Dean and I have rehearsed this. Man, not at all. Not even once. It's going to be amazing. So, I'm Jason Powell, IT director here.
And I'm Dean Lisenby, Vice President of Corporate Operations for ACS Technologies. So, glad to be here.
Yeah, Dean was at the very first roundtable. Yes. He was not allowed to talk at it during sessions, but, you know.
Yep, so let me give you a quick background here. So, ACS Technologies, you probably know us as a church management software company, correct? That's what everybody knows us as. But several years ago, we had to tackle this thing called PCI. Anybody dealing with PCI? We spent a lot of time and money on PCI. We invested in people, tools, et cetera, to make sure all of our online giving stuff is very secure. And then last year, we were able to partner with / acquire Higher Ground Technologies. And Higher Ground has a reputation for being focused on managed services for the church, right? They have a few for-profit businesses, but for the most part, I'd say 85, 90% of their customers are church and nonprofit organizations. And so we wanted to take what we knew from PCI and all the tools that we have that we use internally and see if we can apply that to churches. And so we reached out to Jason. So, hey, bud, since, you know, we like each other, what if we did a vulnerability assessment / pen test on your network, and we'll do it at no cost,
woohoo,
if you let us reveal the results on stage? Ooh, right? All right, so how did it go? Let's start with that.
Yeah, so that was the pitch. It was, hey, we're looking to blaze some new territory, offer a new thing for our customers, and even customers, people that aren't ACS customers yet. And it was like, you know, that'd be awesome, because we've been wanting to, like, have vulnerability scan, pen test stuff done for a long time, but every time we got a quote, it was like $15,000, $20,000, and it's like, yep, nope, not going to do that. So when Dean started, you know, talking about what they could provide and for the low cost of nothing, I was like, oh, heck yeah, we're going to do this. So how what else would you like me to say here?
I think we just go straight to the results.
Okay.
Will that work?
Go to the results.
Everybody want to see the results? Now, before I hit this button, let me make sure. You guys know that these guys are smart. They do good things here, right? Here's the results. Oh, God. Just kidding. One more slide. I forgot about this one. So I want to make sure you know our approach real quick. I'll hit these real quick, 30 seconds. That's how much we rehearsed this, by the way. We didn't even know what slide was next. So we use the same tools internally that we are using for this scan. We use the industry leader Nessus scanner. You guys know Nessus? Tenable, anybody? Tenable Nessus? That's the tool we use, which, of course, uses the common vulnerabilities and exposures, the CVD ID, so you know what exposure you have. You can go look it up, Google it, all that good stuff. And, of course, we have credentialed folks internally that we're required to have that for PCI, so we want to put those guys to work for you. That's what we want to do. And, of course, everything that the software finds, we go back and manually make sure that is legit. And so everything's manually verified. So here's the results. Sorry about that.
Beautiful.
Beautiful.
It's actually better than Justin and I were anticipating. A few critical, couple high, mediums, and lows. So I will also say that when we began the scan, we provided a VPN tunnel to Dean's team. And the first time they tried to scan, they crashed our firewall, like locked it up solid. It was great. So a reboot later, it was like, what is going on? Maybe that was just a weird quirk. So I was like, hey, let's try the scan again. And the firewall crashed once again, like just cratered hard. So what I thought was cool is that Dean's team went to work to work with Justin to try to figure out, you know, is there some config setting or something about the VPN tunnel that needs tweaked or adjusted? So I felt like they really went above and beyond to help us figure out a firewall issue that really wasn't, you know, something they needed to necessarily monkey with. And in the end, we decided that our SonicWall firewall just, for whatever reason, wasn't going to be able to cut the mustard. So installed a virtual machine inside, they remoted it, and did the scan that way. So I thought that was really cool that, you know, they didn't go, oh, it's your problem, sorry, we can't, you know, go any further. It was like, hey, it's a problem, what else could we do to help? We put in a ticket to SonicWall, and they never replied back, so yay. Or we're shopping firewalls if you, yeah.
We know people, right?
So when we got the results back, this is the only graph we got. It wasn't very helpful. No, I'm kidding. We got a very detailed report of the device, all of the juicy information about said device, operating system, blah-bitty-blah-bitty-blah. And then what the vulnerability was exactly. And then not only that, here's how to remediate it. Like, so it wasn't just, you know, hey, this thing is bad, you should fix it, good luck. It was, hey, this is a big hole, here's how to fix said thing. So we looked through the list and very quickly discovered that the vast majority of what was being showed to us was a single Windows machine that sits up underneath our help desk bench. It just sits there. It's one of those things where you kind of forget it's there. It's kind of doing its thing. We use it for some old phone system configuring, and it just has not had any love in a long time. So we immediately were like, well, we can fix a whole lot of this by just going over and going boop on the power button. And it's like, hey, we've solved a bunch. There are a few other things that were like, oh, that's interesting. Forgot about that box or that Debian. You know, again, it's a VM that maybe was spun up for one particular thing, and you just kind of forget it's sitting there doing its deal. And it's like, well, we can power that thing off. So in the end, I thought it was really, really helpful for us to be able to get an idea of where are our vulnerabilities, that our firewall is kind of sucky, and that Dean's team was willing to go above and beyond. Of course, then I asked Dean the question, it's like, well, so it was free to Grainger, but you know, if you're gonna pitch this thing to other churches and it's gonna cost them like 12 grand or something like that, very few people are gonna bite on it. And so Dean's response was,
well, it's not free. No, here's what I would tell you.
You first, get a scan and you get a scan.
Exactly. There we go. No, here's what I would tell you. It's obviously it depends on scope, right? So how big your network is, how many devices have to be scanned, all that good stuff. But I can tell you this, that the churches that we are engaged with today are paying somewhere between, ready, $800 and about $2,000 for a scan. The largest churches
cheap.
Were paying $2,000. I mean, it's dirt cheap, guys. Yeah. Our point here for us, and I hope you'll take our words to heart. We're trying to build the kingdom. We want to protect you guys. We have these tools already in place. How can we point them at something else to take advantage of reducing our risk footprint? So I would ask you to stop by our booth. I have been on I've been around this place a long time, IT Roundtable. I've never sold anything.
Wow.
True, like I've never stood on a stage, I've never said, come by our booth. I just don't believe in that. If we're good enough, you'll come by. In this case, I'm gonna basically say, this is brand new service. Come by our booth, take a look at the sample report that we have. We brought some sample reports to show you. Talk to our staff that's in the booth. We'd love to help you. And in the end, reduce your risk footprint. That's the goal.
Yep, so. Absolutely. And then bang for the buck, man. Nobody can touch you. So.
I believe that to be true, so let's do it. That's our 10 talk.
It worked. Very nice. Okay, so for my 10 talk, it's going to be cyber insurance basics, or as my wife would tell you, nap time. Would be. I get reminded constantly that not everybody wants to talk about insurance day in, day out, and it might be more like nobody wants to talk about that, but it is something that, as I've had a chance to converse with a few people over at the booth, it's unfortunately becoming much more and more prevalent all the time. So at DataStream Cyber Insurance, what we do is take a proactive, data-driven approach by partnering with MSPs, MSSPs, as well as other insurance brokers, because we only do cyber insurance. We're a pure-play cyber company, and that's our sole focus. As this is a pretty short talk, I'm going to kind of fast forward to what I would usually wrap up with, because when you reverse your strategy, that always works, right, too? So I'm going to go towards the end of what remediation looks like. What is the point of having an insurance policy, right, particularly in something that is as sensitive as a potential cyber attack? You know, you can read through the policy, you can make sure everything's there, and we do free, no pressure whatsoever, policy reviews day in and day out. That's one of our core services. But what is the point of even getting a cyber insurance policy? It's if something happens, that you have a whole team of professionals there to help you through an event. What will likely be some of the most stressful 2 or 3 days that you face in a long time, you want to have a team there that is experienced and able to handle every facet of what you're going through. So one of the things we do when issuing a policy is we do a cyber posture audit check, which just verifies all the aspects of an application and expedites the end nature of a claim. Because one of the myths that I hear a lot, and if I am able to kind of knock my own industry a little bit, it's that people are nervous that if there is a claim, it's not going to pay out. It's a valid concern and something we take a very proactive approach towards. So when we issue a policy, we do a cyber posture audit that verifies the application and makes it crystal clear to insurance adjusters that they should pay out in full expeditiously. We also do what's called an incident response plan. So we have access to a 24/7 hotline that goes to a breach coach, so it's basically a law firm. They have 90 plus lawyers that all they do is cyber incident response. So all of these things you see on the screen are aspects of what could happen when an incident occurs. So first, there's a forensic investigator. They're going to see what is happening in the system, what data was potentially breached, or if it were a ransomware event, they're gonna say, hey, what's the state of the backups? And that's where we really work with IT consultant companies, MSPs or MSSPs, and I would urge everyone in here that to tighten up that partnership or with your internal, everyone here with your internal staff, just to go through backups, right? Make sure your backups are in a place that you might be able to not pay a ransom. Or if this did happen, that there's a surprising amount of room for negotiation in ransomware. So the breach coach will have not only a forensic expert, they'll have a ransomware negotiator, they will have a public relations team if you want to put a press release out. Or if there was a data breach, there'll be a way to set up a call center that's already accessible to notify people. So these are the type of things that I try to think about when looking through just what could be a very stressful time. It's that team, right? That team that's gonna get you through there and thinking ahead with an incident response plan. And it's always interesting to do those because it's such a simple document. It's a one-page document that we're actually gonna print out or put on a USB drive, but I like the old school, print it out, put it in a folder, put it in a drawer, because in that event that the computers won't turn on, you go back to the old handwritten notes and phone numbers, and those are the type of things that will get you through. So that's sort of the end. I wanted to start with that because whenever I have less than, say, an hour to talk, I'm gonna run out of time. So I wanted to start with some things. I just want to be top of mind for everyone. We do a lot of educational aspects, whether it be those policy reviews I mentioned already, or be putting together incident response plans, or we have monthly tabletop exercises that are open to everyone. We just want to help stop cyber criminals in general, and so we offer these free for anyone to join. But going back to now the beginning of what are the requirements to get a cyber insurance policy? This is probably the number two, well, I guess I would say myth, although it does have some truth to it, just like that concern of will this policy pay out? This myth has some concerns too. There are some basic requirements for obtaining a cyber insurance policy. The first is multi-factor authentication, which I'm sure everyone here is well aware of that. There are actually a couple of carriers that will issue policies without this in place, but I would say probably by the end of this year, or certainly within 18 months, as an educated guess, it will be a requirement. And just something that's pretty straightforward to do and surprisingly effective, to be completely transparent with you. It is a very effective tool. To have those offsite or cloud backups, as I mentioned, this puts you just in such a great place, not just looking at ransomware and negotiations, but peace of mind to know that you are prepared, and there's a lot of great techniques there that I can breeze through because you're all professionals in that industry. And then an endpoint detection and response system. So these first two, MFA and backups, are more or less requirements to obtaining a cyber insurance policy. An EDR or an MDR tool, which is just monitoring the endpoints of your system. It's not a requirement, but it certainly is something that will help to lower a premium to get you a better rate. And also it's just another tool that's highly recommended because it's very effective. And I'm just gonna go ahead and open all four of these up in the interest of time here. So we are a data-driven company, and a few points here that I just wanna highlight while I have the time are first that a rider or an endorsement to a commercial general policy is really not enough. So whenever you look at a commercial policy, which is a general insurance policy, there's typically an option to add on a cyber rider. What you really want to look for is a standalone cyber policy. As is the nature of insurance, if it's not written in the policy, it's not covered. So please remember that, a standalone cyber policy. And ask about the sublimits. And one key thing that I always look for first, and I'll leave with this, is the difference between pay on behalf and buy reimbursement. This applies to all insurance, but particularly in cyber insurance, where a claim may have to be paid out within a week or a few days in full. Think of this as the difference between using your own credit card and the company credit card. So make sure your policy has this quote unquote pay on behalf feature, which means the insurance company pays the bills directly, and not the reimbursement feature, which means you pay up front and then file for a reimbursement, which will get paid, but it might be 30 days later, and that's not fun for anyone. So I think I'm at my time here. Thank you very much for listening to insurance, and I only saw one or two people fall asleep, so that's kind of a record for me. I appreciate that.
I do this a lot, and I learned something. Thank you. Hey, everyone. I'm really excited. Super appreciate that.
We had a lead pastor lose all of his personal data this past year, and it's almost like the stages of grief. I talked to him one day, and he was super calm, and I ran to his wife a few days later, and she's like, yeah, that's because you missed the weekend. Gives me the heebie-jeebies. Are we good? All right, so my name's Stephen Kane. I'm from Family Church in South Florida. We have 11 campuses throughout the West Palm Beach region. Jason's not the only one looking for help. So if you look on this map, we do have Miami super close, and this is the Bahamas over there, like real Bahamas. This is our downtown campus, and it is 1 mile from the beach, like exactly. So you could come to Indiana, or there are some options. All right, so I worked at a data center for a while. I worked as a programmer for a while, and I'm just here to talk about redundancy for any church of any size. One of the things that we learned at the data center was to use multiple paths to organize everything and then to monitor it to make sure it's working well. So let's take you to our IT closet right now, which is we have a whole whopping one rack at this point, but that's okay. We were able to get rid of some old servers. So we have two UPSs that are connected to separate electrical circuits. Those electrical circuits are on different phases of electricity. Each one of the UPSs is running no more than 45% usage. If you were to unplug or disconnect or whatever you want to do to one of those UPSs right now, you would lose one of two internet connections, one of two firewalls, one of two distribution switches, one of two power supplies and all of our access level switches, and one of two physical servers. So it is legitimately a crisis if that were to happen, but it is a very predictable crisis, and we can then walk into that situation, determine what's going on. And while we don't have a hot swappable solution for that, we do have like a 15-minute swappable solution for that. We move some power cords from the UPS that's not working to the one that is. Because we're only at 45% usage, the UPS that's there will take all the load, and then we'll just keep right on running. And in that case, we would lose a little bit of functionality, but most of our users would have no idea that anything bad had ever happened, because bad things do actually happen. We did lose a phase one night at about 5:30 on a Wednesday night, so all of our people were coming for a Wednesday evening stuff. We're walking into the building, and only half of the lights were working, but we still had full internet. Everything was running as expected. So little things like that where we make multiple paths, we provide multiple ways for the electricity to get into the rack, and then we organize everything to make sure that we don't have both servers plugged into the same UPS. Those little subtle details can be the difference between a problem and a crisis. We also had, at one of our campuses this year, we had, due to construction in the area, we had an internet circuit down for more than 30 days. So if we only had one internet circuit at that campus, we would have had a problem because it was Comcast and there was no way I was getting a hold of anybody that could actually do anything. I could call lots of people to tell me other people I could call, but never anybody who would actually take some responsibility for what was happening. So multiple paths are great. You can also use them for your networking as well. Spanning Tree is your friend. It will take care of redundant cables and redundant connections, so all of our access level switches connect to both of our distribution level switches. And all of these kinds of things, no matter the size of your church, I would be happy to talk with you about any of that and help you understand exactly where you are. I've been on the job a little over 3 years, but my first 30 days, we had four hard network outages, and they were all 100% preventable and totally related to this type of thing. It was a sneaker pulling a cable out of a wall, or both of our internet carriers plugged into the same UPS, just very tiny, tiny changes that we were able to make in order to make everything a whole lot more resilient. We do other things as well. We have all these campuses, but we standardize hardware across the board for both switches and firewalls. So when we need to make any kind, if there was perhaps a firewall failure at a campus, we can go get a cold spare sitting on the shelf. If we had like 10 different versions of firewalls, that would make that kind of stuff much more complicated. So then we monitor things. These are free monitoring tools, Cacti and NSN. Cacti will monitor your devices, make sure they're all there. If they're running SNMP, you can get fancy graphs and things like that. NF Send is super convenient because Cacti will tell you, hey, there is traffic on this port. NF Send will tell you what that traffic exactly is. So you can see the source IP address, source port, destination IP address, destination port, and your firewall spits out all the information for NF Send. So it's pretty convenient. So this is what single path meets desperation looks like. So it's the yellow cable over here that's important. We walked into a campus that we partnered with in the last year. This is their main switch. They had a few VLANs. The yellow cable was their main connection to the internet, and I'll zoom in a little bit on this beauty. So this is a delicate copper star that all of their internet ran through. Not well, but it did run through it. But this is what this church did. The internet came in an outbuilding, not in the main building. It was very complicated. And of course, it's indoor rated cable going down a fence line, through a puddle, up a wall, and everywhere else, just the regular stuff. But they had no choice because they only had a single cable when they ran it initially from the main building underground to this remote building. So these things actually do happen. We walk in on stuff like this, not regularly. This is about the most egregious thing I've ever seen. I mean, come on, let's be ridiculous. I mean, there's not even wire nuts on there. I mean, throw a wire nut or something on there, and it may look like fun, but it is quite beautiful. So that's where we are. I thank you guys for listening. If you have any questions, you can stop me tomorrow. I'll be wearing a bright orange shirt, so I'm super easy to find.
Hello, thanks for being here. My name's Terry Shardock from Bay Presbyterian Church in Bay Village, Ohio, which is a suburb just west of Cleveland. Our church is on the north coast. That's Lake Erie in the background, and that's our building. Over the years, most of my adult life, I've had a lot of people ask me, how do you stay so calm? You know, why doesn't anything ever rattle you? How do you not let stuff get to you? And so many people would refer to me as the calming influence. I'll bring Terry, and he's the calming influence. So I finally actually stopped to think about it, and I came up with the six Terryisms. These are just things that I've come to learn and believe over my life. None of it's original. All of it's just learned. Anybody in here born in or around 1974? All right, good. When you were one, I was going to college, sophomore year, commuting to Cleveland State University, and I would have to drive down from, I lived in Lakewood, which is another suburb of Cleveland, and during rush hour every day. And I would complain about the rush hour every day, and I would get mad because the traffic was keeping me from being happy and really getting to me. And my oldest brother introduced me to Dr. Wayne Dyer at the time. He gave me a set of, ready for this, audio tapes, cassettes. If you don't know what that is, you can Google ancient audio storage or something. Wayne Dyer is basically a positive mental attitude guy. Yada yada, self-help guru, all that kind of stuff. I learned a lot from listening to him and reading his books and stuff like that, except it wasn't long before I realized there was a really essential missing piece, and that missing piece was Jesus Christ. He was associating everything with the power of the universe and, you know, things that was very existential, and that was really good, and the stuff I was learning was good, but once I realized there's no God here, there's no Jesus, I kind of started paying more attention to that kind of stuff. But I learned a lot from him. And one of the main things Wayne Dyer would teach is that our thoughts affect our emotions. In other words, if someone passed away in your life and you didn't hear about it for 3 days, it's hearing about it, it's thinking about it that's causing you to be sad, not the actual event. If you say, elevators scare me, That's not really accurate. Elevators don't do anything to scare people. They don't shudder, well, they do sometimes, but they don't shudder and roar to make you scared. You're choosing to have scary thoughts about elevators. So when you can change how you think about something, then theoretically you can change, you can control your emotions. Couple of personal experiences. A few years ago, our family went to Universal Studios, and I've always been bothered by hot weather and heat and stuff like that. And I just decided going out, because we were going in July, and this was in Florida, and I said, you know what, I'm just not going to let the heat bother me this year. I'm just going to not even talk about it or think about it or especially not complain about it. And it actually worked. And a lot of it was thanks to the stuff I had learned from Wayne Dyer. And so I came up with terrorism number one, the traffic doesn't care. When you're in heavy traffic, you can decide how to think about it or how emotional to be about it, but the traffic isn't going to change and it doesn't care. The rain doesn't care, the heat doesn't care, the snow doesn't care. It's what you're thinking in your brain that's going to affect how it's going to affect you. That takes us on to terrorism number two, the case of the less than perfect headboard. A few months ago, my wife and I bought a metal headboard for our guest room, and they came in, the delivery people actually installed it on the frame and everything, and that was cool. And after they left, we realized there were two little flaws in it. There was like one weld that wasn't complete, had a little hole in it, and another part that was like brushed away. And I realized I had two choices, two options. I could call and yell, do you have any idea how much I paid for this? I can't believe your delivery guys didn't see it when they delivered it. You have to do something about this. Or I could call and tell, hey, yeah, thanks. Hey, we got this headboard, and there's a couple things in it, and I'm, you know, I just need to take care of it. There's a little hole, and there's, you know, this. And that's what I chose to do. And they would have gladly exchanged it. But then the guy said, or, if you'd prefer, we could give you a 50% refund on your credit card. So my wife and I decided, those flaws really aren't that bad. And that headboard is still there. We turned it around, the flaws are in the back, we're all good. James 1, 19 and 20, everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to become angry, because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. So basically what I'm sharing, what I've learned over the years, is right in the book, and this is, I take that to heart. That brought me to terrorism number two, respond, don't react. If you respond to a situation, you'll be able to handle it much better, much calmer, live your life a lot better than if you react to it. On to number three. Everybody has problems every day. Well, some of you might have perfect lives, but most of us don't. And all I'm suggesting with this is a shift in thinking, a shift in responding. You know, it could be related to work, it could be related to relationships, marriage, whatever. But I'm just suggesting that you take what you see as a problem and just use the word project. Even just changing that vocabulary can make a huge difference. At church, when somebody calls me up and says, hey, Terry, I got a problem with this printer. I can't get anything. I said, well, okay, let's figure out how to fix it because it becomes a project in my mind. I learned a long time ago that it's not very easy to get excited about a problem, but it's kind of easy to get excited about a project because then I get to start looking for the solutions. So terrorism number three, Proverbs, as a man thinks, so he is. Change your problems to projects, and it's a lot easier to think more positive about them. So think of it as a project, not a problem. Have you ever had anybody ever jump to the wrong conclusion, or misjudge something, or assume something, or surmise, conclude, took for granted, supposed, presumed, guessed, all of those things? A couple of personal examples. We were going to go out to dinner with some friends, and our friend's wife said, oh, I looked on the website, and it says they're not serving, because of COVID, in the dining room. You can only get carry out. So they were going to get carry out and bring it over. I thought, COVID's been like 2 years at this point, and a lot of restaurants were going back. So I called them. I called them and I said, hey, are you guys serving in the dining room? And they said, yeah. And I said, oh, because the website says this. Yeah, we haven't gotten a chance to change that yet, you know. So that was a simple matter of, well, let's take the next step and find out for sure that that's the case. One of Wayne Dyer's examples was a gentleman on a bus with three really unruly kids. They're just running all over, making all kinds of noise, and he's just sitting there kind of dejected, and people are complaining and, you know, acting disgusted. And somebody just finally went over to him and said, hey, it looks like you're really having these kids are really giving you a hard time today, huh? And he said, yeah, we're just coming back from the hospital. They just lost their mom, and I just don't know what we're going to do. Well, doesn't that change your paradigm? But without all the information, there's no way to know what's going on in that man's heart or mind. I had another personal experience. We had an event at church, and I came down to take care of something, and one of the ladies that I know really well said to me, hey, look who came back to help, because she hadn't been at church for a while. And I said, oh, great to see you, you know. And this person was very reserved and just kind of said, yeah, and that was about it. I went home and I said, hey, you know, I saw this person at church today and she was kind of cold to me, you know. She's really, I didn't know what, I thought she'd be excited about being back or, you know. And my wife said, well, yeah, you know, she did just lose her husband 2 weeks ago. Oh, yeah. So without that information, you know, I misjudged what she was experiencing. So terrorism number 4, get all the facts before reaching a conclusion or a judgment. 9 to 5. Have you ever said to anybody, no thanks, I'm good, or, you know, I know you're busy, I don't want to bother you, or had anybody say that to you? Well, Philippians 2:4 says, let each of you look not only to your own interests, but to the interests of others. 1 Peter 10, each of you should use whatever gifts you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. What I found is that when someone asks you for help, they want to help. And when you say, no thanks, I don't want to bother you, or no thanks, I'm good, sometimes I find that kind of disheartening, you know. Or if I offer somebody, they're doing something that I could easily help with that I've done before, I have experience with, and I say, hey, I can help you with that, and they say, no, I'm good. Oh, all right. Well, God's given us these gifts to help each other and has actually suggested that we do. So when you deny somebody the opportunity to help you, you're actually denying them that they're built something they're built to do. So remember, don't deny someone else the joy of helping. Don't suck that away from them. Ask for help and give them the opportunity to give you a hand. All scripture is God-breathed and useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training. Basically, God has given us and other workers, other people, a lot of great information. Just keep that in mind for a minute. That same eldest brother that gave me the Wayne Dyer tapes, I was having a conversation with him one day, and I don't even remember what it was about, but I said the words, I don't know the first thing about, let's assume shepherding, okay? I don't know the first thing about shepherding. And his response was, well, what do you think the first thing might be? I said, I don't know, get some sheep. And he said, see, you do know the first thing about shepherding. So for those who love God, all things work together for good. Brings us to everything is figure-outable. You can always go get the information. Everything is figure-outable. So in summary, everything's figure-outable. Ask for help. Get all the facts. It's a project, not a problem. Respond. Don't react, and the traffic doesn't care.
This is just funny now, Chris. We gave this a really good test.
So I'll go ahead and share. I haven't worked in IT in about 8 years. So, yeah. And we know this laptop worked a few minutes ago. So if everything fails, it is totally on me. But while the computer's trying to, hey, there we are. So I promise I'm going to be quick. So everybody take 1 minute, stand up right now, because you've been sitting here for like an hour and 15. Arms to the sky, jump up and down, do something, because I want you to stay awake, and I know the dinner is coming soon is coming. I promise I only need 6 minutes, because today I am just here to try to pique some interest, that word P-I-Q-U-E, and we're going to start with the fact that everybody here is probably lazy somehow, and that's why you chose to work in information technology. Now, that is not an accusation. I will share with all of you, I have spent the whole of my career enjoying the fact that I never want to do something more than thrice. So I will do it once, I will do it twice, and then I'm like, I'm gonna find a way to never do this thing again, if possible. So let's talk about automating ministry. You know, old adage, work smarter, not harder. So what are some things that we can automate with ministry? There are a ton of things we can automate. We can automate data based on data. We can automate notifications. So think of things like, how cool would it be to have a new prayer request enter your church management system and you immediately post that to a Teams channel so that your team can see it and acknowledge it, and there's pretty links and ways to jump back to the CHMS and do things with it. Maybe you want to have a pastor on call and you want that system to automatically rotate, and maybe we're doing something crazy like updating a Twilio phone number so that it rings the pastor's cell phone in after hours. All kinds of crazy things we can automate. We can automate data moving from the CHMS to the website. We can automate media. We can automate all kinds of things. Or we wish we could. We really want to be able to set these things and forget them. There are things like help desks. We all know those. We love them. We hate them. We wish we could, you know, reroute certain people's tickets directly to the trash can. Lots of things. But a lot of repetition. No. Those are called EGR. Those are EGR clients. And for those of you who haven't done this long enough, that's extra grace required, EGR. There are a couple of other fun acronyms that we can't talk about because we are in a church. But how can we automate things? So there's all kinds of different ways to automate. You've got batch operations where you're like, so many things queue up, we do something with them. There's timed. Hey, at 5 a.m. every day, do this. And then there's the more fun ones, the, I want to call them, there's near real time. There's also real time, but I'm going to share with you today, real time should be reserved for in-system things. Near real time is probably good enough for most of our automations. So how do we automate things? And some of you are going to be like, yeah. Come on, get on with it. So historically, you're either writing software or buying a purpose-built software. I've had the privilege of doing both of those things. There's also like backdoor SQL. You can write, you know, cron jobs. We can write SQL queries. We can write stored procedures. We can use process engines and routines that are built into the software that we're using. I do, shameless plug, the growth method guys are here. I, like Dean, come from ACS, and I'm not saying go talk to them, but go talk to them if you want an easy button to start automating. They're not what I'm here to talk about today, though. I want to talk about where we need to go next if you're not thinking this way. This room is full of very, very smart people, I know, because I've been hanging out with you for 15 years. Not everybody in this room knows how to write code, wants to write code, cares about writing code. So I'm here today to say we need to stop thinking code. We need to start thinking about no code. We need to start looking at low code, no code solutions. There's three on the screen right now. So Power Automate, which is very, very easy, fun, and cheap. It's less than $15 a month for you to get started, for you and your church. Zapier's a little bit more expensive. I threw MuleSoft in there because we're looking at it. We've been playing with it. But a no-code solution provides you with an integration platform or hub, however you want to call it, that will bring hundreds of systems into one space where you can begin to create connections and move data back and forth between those systems. The cool part for this team is you guys all possess most of the core knowledge to go make those things happen. It's not about writing code. It's about understanding the data you have and where you want that data to go. And I think this is a room full of people who have been dying to do some process engineering, dying to make things better, because I know a lot of you. Like, we want to make things better, and we hate doing things over and over again. So that's a smattering of all the connectors that already exist in Power Automate, to just throw a name on the table. Super cheap, super easy, super cool way to get started with automating your ministry. And what's great is, I'm going to share this with you guys, as a person who has written software for the last 8 to 10 years, I could not write all those connectors in anything. So the advantage here is they're bringing their own connector into the ecosystem and you benefit. So whether your help desk software or your CHMS, Office 365, there's stuff for SharePoint, there's stuff for Teams, there's stuff for Google. So this isn't even a Microsoft or Google stack thing. Everybody is basically figured out. You're either Office 365 or Google. So everybody out there is building the same connectors to make these things possible. So choose your low-code platform. I don't care which one. We're going to focus on Power Automate for the rest of this talk. Find a connector. If there isn't a connector, all of these guys have these very rudimentary API calls. So if you're using systems that have APIs that don't have connectors, it's very easy to get going. All right, this is an example of a very, very boring but very easy Power Automate connector. Here's what's great, and if you're a code writer, I want to encourage you, because I've ignored these things for about the last 2 years. I've known they were there. I played with them a couple times. I'm like, I write code. But I've actually had a couple of interviews with friends of mine who are actually doing this in production live, and they're sharing with me, yeah, we wrote code that did this, but I'm the only one who could maintain it, and I had to write it, compile it, deploy it, and keep a server alive that was doing nothing but this. By moving to Power Automate, by moving to Zapier, all this stuff moves to the cloud. There is no code that you're writing. You literally drag, drop, configure. And here's the best part. If you leave your job, you're setting your church up for someone else to come along. Maybe they can't create it on day one, but they could edit it. They could update it. They could click through each step, follow along, and update those things. So you've got a super simple skill set. You have something that's very maintainable. And the other side of this is no code, no compile. You don't even have all those dependencies. Because how many people have written code out there? Right. So you write it, you stick it in production for a year or two, and then you go back and you're like, oh man, there's all these things that are now out of date. And worse than that, we're hearing about churches. We heard from Chris today, and I didn't even know Chris went through that, so I feel like I need to go give him a hug in a minute. But I've personally dealt with 3 or 4 churches in the last year who have been hit with ransomware, and it has attacked through all kinds of vectors. So the beauty is they're maintaining that secure environment. You're not adding a new surface from a security standpoint. So become an automation master. I'm going to share this with you. Don't think too big. Find the smallest, simplest, dumbest thing to automate and start there. And if you understand, I'm gonna say this to you, seriously, don't say, I'm gonna build a 72-stage process for processing volunteers. Don't do that. Pick something really dumb, like somebody hasn't been here for 4 weeks, flag their record. Pick something really, really easy, because the bigger it is, the harder it is, and the best thing you can do is automate one thing and get some traction. All right, that's it. I want you to think about automate, automate, automate. I will share kind of selfishly for the MP folks. We've got a couple of webinars coming up this fall. We're gonna show you how to do some of this. Again, I'll share the growth method guys are out there. Love for you to chat with them. They help you do a ton of automation very, very simply. It's not this. It's gonna be more like kind of out of the box and canned. And then I did wanna throw out and say, I wanted to give IT OneSource a little bit of a shameless plug to say, I had some problems with my Power Automate licensing. I wanted to say they solved it. So it's always fun to share that. And I will say, all of us know how amazingly simple and straightforward Microsoft licensing is. So if you get stuck, those guys can help. I hope you guys enjoy the rest of the conference and just find something to automate, because we got into IT so we were not doing the same thing over and over and over again. Go do something new. You guys have fun.
Thank you very much to all of our presenters. That wraps up 10 Talks. We actually hit our time. So anybody that's been around for a long time, I feel like all of our presenters, thank you so much. Give us about 10 minutes and we'll be back up here to bless dinner. Welcome to exist.